All over the media since early 2020, you've probably heard reports on the impacts that the COVID-19 pandemic has had internationally, nationally, and even provincially, whether that be impacts on the economy or people's well-being.
The U.S. records more children with COVID than ever before.
Over 1.5 million Canadians are unemployed, and it's expected to get worse before it gets better.
Ontarians need to prepare to take a step back if schools are to remain open.
But what about the pandemic's impact on the local level? How have Ontario's smaller communities fared during these historically trying times? I'm Scott Brooks, and this is a documentary where I'll be focusing on my hometown of Acton, looking to see what impacts the community has felt during the pandemic from the perspectives of those that make up the community.
We were down about $3.8 million.
All volunteerism ended.
I don't sleep. I have nightmares.
Our sales just dropped more than 50%.
So listen along as I take you through the local impacts of COVID-19. Acton is a historic community with a population of about 9,500 and is located within the town of Halton Hills, situated at the north end of Halton Region. Throughout its history, Acton has seen its fair share of hardships, such as surviving through world wars, the Spanish flu of 1918, the Great Depression, and even the closure of its largest industry, the Beardmore Tannery, in 1986. But as a local historian, I wonder how the COVID-19 pandemic compares to similar events of the past. Unfortunately, when looking through local newspapers, not much of the actual impacts on people's well-being were reported on the Spanish flu of 1918, making it tricky to compare to the COVID-19 pandemic. However, while there wasn't a whole lot reported on the direct impacts, it was recorded that, in the fall of 1918, there were no Thanksgiving services in any local churches, everything being closed for several weeks in October by the Department of Health. And then again, schools, churches, and public events were closed in December through to mid-January. Now that we know that social events and associated gatherings had been impacted during the Spanish flu of 1918, without a doubt, it would be safe to say that the citizens of Acton have seen a similar impact, if not on a greater scale, during the COVID-19 pandemic. With the pandemic being declared in March of 2020, major events in Acton, such as Canada Day, the Santa Claus Parade, the Terry Fox Run, and the Leathertown Festival, have been impacted in some way by the pandemic, with the Acton Fall Fair being no exception. At least for most of the events, they were modified to either be a virtual event or held in a smaller form, whereas the Fall Fair could not. The Acton Fall Fair has been held annually by the Acton Agricultural Society since 1913, and 2020 marked the first time that it would not be held.
Some of the initial concerns were, we didn't know if we could have a fair, but a lot of people were concerned about if we could do it and whether we're having the sanitation and things like that.
Agricultural Society President Dave Somerville and Board Director George Henderson say it has been a challenge deciding not to hold a fair since 2020 while working with community partners and keeping safety in mind.
2020 was a real hard one because the numbers weren't there. And one of the biggest things is the age of all our volunteers at Home Crafts and out in the field and wherever. And that was a big concern because you don't want to expose your volunteers to such a huge risk. So
we kept delaying the decision.
Yes.
We kept delaying it.
We dragged our feet. But
because we thought, okay, it'll be spiked and then all of a sudden it'll get better, but it never did get better.
It never did get better because we never had a vaccine.
Mm. No. Yeah. And so, it was a big disappointment for, for us, of course, and a big disappointment for the whole community.
And then 2021 was easier because things were not getting better. We'd been in this for so long that people knew, it just was not going to happen. And there was a glimmer of hope there about middle of June where things were going down before this fourth wave started. And I lost some sleep in those 2 weeks because it looked like we might be able to do this. And then all of a sudden, the numbers started to rise again. We got into the fourth wave. And
yep.
And it was going to be hard to police things, like, you know, who's got it and who doesn't, and masks and the sanitation.
Well, see, the other thing is that we are basically on Halton Hills property here.
We didn't have the final say.
Yes. Yeah. So that was all those combination of things was kind of working against us.
Yes. And the thing that we have to remember is we have to keep anybody that comes in here, whether they're a volunteer or a paying customer or a vendor or,
an exhibitor,
they have to be safe. Yeah, they have to be safe.
We're responsible for keeping them safe.
Despite not holding a fair for 2020 and 2021, Somerville says the financial impacts on the agricultural society has been minimal thanks to support through government grants and by keeping things shut down, a cost-saving measure compared to planning and then losing funds if an event were to be canceled. Henderson adds that the impacts are to a minimum due in part to strong revenue from previous years.
Like, we've had good weather these past 5+ years.
Yes.
So we've had good gate receipts.
Yes.
And so all in all, we've been able to, survive this year when there hasn't been any money coming in.
Somerville says support has been pretty good during these times, and when the fair does return in 2022, there may be some changes made on the fairgrounds.
People will be coming. They'll be here. There's a little bit of doubt in the back of my mind, but not a lot. The people back and support this fair, and I'm looking forward to it. And it will be what the guidelines have. Are telling us what to do if we have the QR code on the way in, or lots of sanitizer. And, that's not a bad thing, all the sanitizer and stuff like that. So, yeah, there's probably a few little upgrades we're going to have to do, but I have yet to see anything big or huge that we have to do.
It has also been noted that, throughout the recent pandemic, there had been an increase in the impacts on mental health with the cancellation of social events and the ability of not being able to freely go out in public during the various lockdowns. Clark Somerville, a local councillor in Acton for the town of Halton Hills and Halton Regional Council, says he began to experience forms of restlessness once the pandemic started and lockdowns were immediately put in place.
Well, I found that as we've hit the waves, and we're talking about the fourth wave, for me personally, it affects me is that I don't sleep. And when I do sleep, when we're into that really bad time, I have nightmares. And I am one who never remembers dreams. But I remember very vivid dreams during that first wave because it was fear. We didn't know what was going to happen. Like, we went in a matter of days from seeing everything shut down around us, people being told to go home for March break, take the time off. We closed every recreational facility. We don't like doing that as a municipality. We had to close public buildings. We had to do that.
With the closure of public facilities, I asked Somerville if he heard from his constituents regarding the shutdowns and what their concerns were.
Daily. We would have groups phoning up, like a senior swimming group, phoning up and saying, can we get space at a town facility to be able just to meet so we can have that social aspect? We had it from people phoning up and just in fear of saying, well, what do we do about this? And you'd have to calm them, even though you didn't have all the answers and you had fear yourself in some things.
Since public facilities were closed, Town of Halton Hills acting CEO Chris Mills says the town experienced its own impacts with great losses in revenue.
Yeah, there's significant loss in program revenue, facility rentals, and a lot of other areas. But in 2020, we calculated that we were down about $3.8 million due to COVID. So we were at about a $3.8 million deficit.
While facilities were closed, according to Mills, the town was able to provide support to the user groups that were affected by the closures.
Within that 3.8 that I mentioned, we did listen to a lot of our community groups, and we did a lot of fee waivers, and we restructured some loans and rental agreements that they had, because we recognized they weren't getting any revenue in from their users, and we wanted to make sure that they were supported and that they were ready to come back once the regulations allowed them to provide those services.
Even though it was a tough decision to close public facilities, Mills says the town's priority was safety.
Our main priorities were to keep both the community and staff safe. We really wanted to make sure that we were on top of all of the best medical information we had, and that we put those protocols, safety protocols, in place early on.
As social events and groups were suspended, Liz Bailey, as a longtime active Acton community member, shared with me some of the impacts that the pandemic has had on the local social groups and programs that she belongs to.
The Links to Care volunteering had stopped right away. I drove seniors in a program called Wheels to Meals, where we would drive seniors to restaurants every other week. So, of course, you could not be in a car or anything like that. So the volunteering with Links to Care for people not employed by Links to Care ended. All volunteerism ended with that. The Heritage Acton, that too, came to a full stop volunteering for that. Our building, the Acton Town Hall Center, relies on events as fundraisers, and we couldn't do any events. It also relies on renting the rooms, and even now, the most we can have, the most people we could have in there are 22, and they must wear masks at all times.
And including school as a social aspect, Bailey, being a retired educator, also gave me some of her thoughts on how education had been handled and the effects it has had on all involved.
What the teachers have been asked to do is Herculean. I do believe that the public have seen what it's like then through virtual teaching. The stress of, and what goes on in a classroom, curriculum, how much curriculum, and what teachers they were told a couple of days before some of the changes that were taking place. And to get ready for that is, it's amazing. They certainly have been frontline workers, for sure. As far as the virtual learning, it hasn't been a great experience for my grandchildren. The one in high school, fine. But it just wasn't the same as that personal interaction. And how can it be? And you're sitting in your bedroom or on your Chesterfield, and you're expected to be paying attention, and the teachers are doing their best to call on everybody and make sure they're engaged. It has been a nightmare.
Now that we've heard some of the social and mental impacts of the pandemic, let's take a moment to look into a bit of the local COVID-19 statistics. When looking at the number of COVID cases between March of 2020 and October 2021, Halton Region reported a total of 273 cases in Acton. That number makes up about 2.87% of the approximately 9,500 people that reside in Acton. The 273 cases that were reported in Acton are out of the 2,129 cases within Halton Hills, a municipality of over 61,000 people. And when looking at demographics in Halton Hills, females made up about 50.5% of cases reported, while males made up about 49.3% of those cases. It is also to note that the age groups with the most cases reported are those between 20 to 39 and 40 to 59, with little more than 600 cases reported within each group. While there is no specific breakdown available for each individual community on the number of hospitalizations and deaths related to the virus, what is known is that between March of 2020 and October 2021, 103 Halton Hills residents were hospitalized, and at least 58 to have contracted the virus had passed away. When it comes to the administering of the COVID-19 vaccine, as of the end of September 2021, 82% of eligible Halton Region residents, those that are 12 years and older, received two doses. As part of the vaccination program, Halton Hills Acting CAO Chris Mills gives praise as to how well the town has been able to coordinate the vaccine rollout in partnership with the region.
What we were really proud of is working seamlessly with the region to set up the vaccination clinic at the Gellert. It was a really nice to see how two levels of government could work so closely together and so quickly, I must say, and almost seamlessly have that place open, operational, and accepting clients when the region received the vaccines.
With having looked at the social impacts and COVID statistics, it is now time to turn to how the local business community was impacted by the pandemic. It's no secret that local businesses have been bearing the brunt of the pandemic, especially with all the lockdowns that were put in place by the Ontario provincial government. But what impact did the pandemic actually have on the businesses that are found within the heart of the community, particularly in downtown Acton? According to downtown Acton BIA manager Alex Hilson, at the beginning of the pandemic, there was quite a bit of fear and uncertainty as no one really knew what to expect.
None of us knew what we were dealing with, right? It was, they used to use the word unprecedented a lot, and it was. So I think it was just fear, you know, like, what are we, and I don't think the focus was just on the business at the beginning particularly. It was like, what are we gonna do to get through this? Like, am I gonna get sick? Are people I know gonna get sick? Like, are people I know gonna die? There was just, the spiral of anxiety for that first wave.
Once the initial fear subsided, Hilson says business owners began to look at long-term plans for their business's survival.
As things have changed the last couple waves and we're returning to more of that that normalcy and sort of a natural state of calm, that's when, you know, we're hearing things have changed. Now business owners are starting to think about, you know, the financial side, like, this isn't good. I can't do this forever, right? Like, how am I going to deal with this? How am I going to make my business viable? How am I going to live my life?
Interestingly, even with businesses dealing with the various lockdowns and restrictions, Hilson reports that the majority of them within the BIA district have done relatively well.
We've actually been very, very fortunate in our downtown. There's been a couple closures, but the businesses that have closed have, you know, one of them just moved to a different community. There was a rent dispute. Well, it probably had something to do with the pandemic, but it wasn't, they didn't close, right? There was one business that sort of moved online, moved mobile. The one business, the owner died, right? So there was sort of normal churn. More businesses have opened up than closed in our downtown, and some of those businesses are, you know, have had a good start. They've had a lot of good community support. They're previous business owners. They have existing clientele. So we've been really, really fortunate at this point.
While most downtown Acton businesses have fared the storm quite well, Saeed Sadiq, owner of the Clay Oven, an authentic Indian restaurant since 2016, says the initial wave of the pandemic was a struggle for his business.
So the March was, like, you know, very devastating for us because our sales just dropped more than 50%. So that was a shocking thing for us. And we feel like, you know, what would happen coming days, months, and, you know, and how would overcome these events. So that was quite, you know, worrying thing for us, for sure.
According to Sadiq, since the pandemic first hit, he has seen a shift in operations as part of his restaurant's survival.
We were not able to invite people for dining. So mostly the biggest change that we were heavily dependent on takeout. So there was no dining for the whole year.
Sadiq says even though business has been pretty good with the changes made, it is far from what it used to be and that there are still some challenges ahead.
Our new normal would be way different than what we used to see, right?
Yeah. So,
and dining is a key for any restaurant. The biggest challenge is it cost us a lot. Like when you hire staff, simultaneously, if you don't get the dining, then you can't afford to pay the staff. So it's just vice versa. So like it affects a lot. Though we are trying to hire people, but same time we are worrying like if we can get enough dining people, so I guess it'll be hard for us to keep them, right? So that is the challenging part for us.
Acting CAO for the town of Halton Hills, Chris Mills, says the town gave support to local businesses by providing information on the government financial aid that was available to them.
A lot of our work was to respond to that and make sure that we were giving the business community all the support we can to understand what those programs were and how they could access those programs so that they were not left behind and that they had the financial support that they needed.
Another way the town was able to provide support to local businesses, according to Councillor Clark Somerville, was by helping clarify which businesses could resume operations during the reopening phase of the pandemic.
A pet grooming place. When they did the, they reopened back January, I think it was, they originally weren't on one of the first lists that they could reopen. But when you looked at it, they actually were. So they're phoning saying, you know, well, who do we contact about this? Because we should be able to. They are open in, say, Vaughan, for an example. And it's getting our staff to look at it and say, yeah, they can be open.
Despite there being some tough times for the many businesses that line the streets of downtown Acton, Hilson remains optimistic for the future.
The future's looking bright. Whatever's coming up next, you know, there might be some dark times still, but we're going to get through it. All through this, people have been saying, you know, like, how are our small businesses going to do this? Like, how are we going to, like, they've been shut for months. Like, how are they going to survive? They're still there. You know what I mean? So it's a testament to the resiliency of the human spirit. And we're lucky to have that.
And it is that resiliency of the human spirit that shall keep the community of Acton going, regardless of the impacts that have been felt during the dark times of the pandemic and the challenges that may still lie ahead. I can say that it has been an interesting journey, taking you through some of the impacts that the community has felt during these historic times from the perspectives of those that make up the community. And it will be equally as interesting to see what the future will be in the months and years ahead as we move forward from this pandemic. I'm Scott Brooks, and this has been the Local Impacts of COVID-19.